Now we have seen a lot of new concepts, and we have seen how we can make calculations with them. So now the issue is, what are their mathematical properties? And then we are back into our cases with normal spaces, Hilbert spaces, Banach spaces, and so on. So let me start by remind you something that we did in the second week. So we even have it in the book. So what we showed in the beginning of the course is that if you look at the continuous functions on the interval a to b, then this is actually a Banach space. And remember, when you say that something is a Banach space, you always need to specify what norm you're thinking about. So we have to say, with respect to the norm, and the one we looked at was the supremum's norm. So we looked at the norm of f infinity, and this is defined by taking the supremum of absolute values f of x, where x runs in the interval AB. It turns out that if you go back and look at what we did at this time, and you apply exactly the same arguments to this space, the space of continuous functions that go to infinity, that go to zero for x going to plus minus infinity, then exactly the same steps will prove that this is also a Banach space. So I will not do that. I just state that this is exactly the same arguments you have to do again. So the same arguments gives, and this is stated in the book as lemma 513, and what it says is that the space of continuous functions that go to zero for x going to plus minus infinity, this is also a Banach space. With respect to exactly the same norm. So this is again called the infinity norm. So the way it is written is as supremum of f of x in absolute value. The only difference is that here we were looking at functions on the interval AB. Now, when we are looking at C0R, we are dealing with functions that are defined on the entire real axis, meaning that the supremum here needs to be taken over x in R. But besides that change, you do exactly the same. We would like to relate that to the space of continuous functions with compact support. And this is what is done in the next lemma. So what this says is that the set of continuous functions with compact support, this is actually a subspace of C0R. Now, what you know, what we just stated here, is that we have a norm on the space C0R. This space is smaller because it's a subspace. So this means that the norm we have on this space, this will also automatically be a norm on this space. So now I just write it down one more time. So again here, we have a norm space. But the surprise is that when we look at this subspace, we get a norm space, but it is no longer a Banach space. So I think we should look at that one more time. So what it says here, we have to prove this lemma. I will prove it in all details. But what it says is the set of continuous functions with compact support, this is a subspace of C0R. On this space, we have a norm. And then if you look at what it means to be a norm, you remember we have these point 1, 2, 3 that we have to check. If you look at all these conditions, you'll see that if they hold on this space, then they automatically hold on a smaller space. You remember one of the conditions is, for example, that the triangle inequality has to hold. So since we have a norm on this space, this means that the triangle inequality holds for functions belonging to this space. But these functions are just special cases of the functions we're dealing with here. So therefore, of course, also the triangle inequality holds on these functions. And if you do this argument for condition 1, 2, and 3, then you'll see that if you have a subspace of something that has a norm, then this subspace is automatically a norm space. The surprise here is that the subspace is not automatically a Banach space. So let's write down again what I had before the break, but we had to take it away. So what did it mean to have a Banach space? We have to check that every Cauchy sequence Fk, k going from 1 to infinity in the space, so let's just again just call the abstract space for V, we have to show that this converts to some V in the space. So we know that the space C0R has this property. Every Cauchy sequence in the space will converge to something in the space. Now what we're dealing with here is just a subspace. And then intuitively, maybe you'll think, then this subspace must also be a Banach space. But the problem is, if you take a Cauchy sequence here, it can very well be that it converts to something that then happens to be outside the space. That means this Cauchy sequence will actually converge, but it does not converge to something that is in the space. It just converts to something that is in this space. So this is the technical complication you'll see, and this is the one that gives the conclusion that CCR is not a Banach space. We will do the details. So now I just told you how it goes. Yeah?
It could be,
but here you are dealing with concrete spaces. This is a concrete space, and this is also a concrete space, because this is exactly this space. And for this space, the answer is it is not a Banach space. So in general, of course, if you're looking at a Banach space, a subspace could be, but in the concrete case we're dealing with here, it is not. So we need these definitions, but I think I can take this away. So let's see how we can prove this. First, I claim that CCR, this is at least a subset of C0R. So this statement says that if you take any function that is here, then it automatically belongs to C0R. And the reason is, if you take a function in CCR, it means that it has compact support. That means the function is doing something, and then suddenly it is equal to zero. If this is satisfied for the function, then that it suddenly is equal to zero for x going to infinity, x going to minus infinity, then it also belongs to C0R, because C0R just means that the function converts to zero. And if it is identically equal to zero out here, then this is satisfied. So this is true. Now, I did not say subset, I said subspace in the result. But you know very well from the exercises how you check that a subset is also a subspace. This is something you have done many times. So let's just put the slide, just to remind ourselves how it goes. So you know, we have this lemma 1, 2, 7, saying that a subset is a subspace if whenever we take a linear combination of elements in the space, then the linear combination will also belong to the space. So we have to check that. So if you take two functions, f and g, belonging to C, C, R, and we take some alpha, beta, belonging to the complex numbers, then what the lemma says is that we need to look at alpha f plus beta g. And we have to check that this function also belongs to C, C, R. But again, what does it mean that a function belongs to C, C, R? The first condition is that it is continuous. That's what you see in the first line. But the function f is continuous, and the function g is continuous. So therefore, the linear combination of the functions is also continuous. And the second condition is about compact support. But the function f has compact support. So this means f is going maybe like this. And the function g has compact support, so maybe g is going like this. So then, when you take this linear combination of the functions f and g, you can see that this will also have compact support, because if you go outside the set where f has compact support and outside the set where g has compact support, then the function will be zero out there. So that means you just take the union of places where f and g are non-zero, and then you go far out, then both of them are equal to zero, and this means that this function will have compact support. So that means you actually get that this is a continuous function with compact support. And this means that we have verified exactly the condition that you see here in the lemma. We have checked this lemma 1, 2, 7. So now we know that it is actually a subspace of C0R. Now, what we want to do is to show that it is not a Banach space. And this is something new for us to find out how we can do that, because so far we have always had some properties we wanted to verify, and then we did some positive arguments saying we can start here and then we can prove that something is satisfied. Now we have to prove that something is not satisfied. So we have to go back and look at what it means to be a Banach space. So the definition here says every Cauchy sequence must converge to some element in the space. So to show that this property is not satisfied, that means exactly to find just one example of a Cauchy sequence that does not converge to some elements in the space. So to show that this is not a Banach space, it is enough just to find one sequence . So we just look for one Cauchy sequence . And now, since we are dealing with functions, let's call the sequence for fk, k equals 1 to infinity. And it should be a sequence in our space. So it belongs to C, C, R. And it should be chosen such that it does not converge to an element in C, C, R. So you see, this is the difference between proving something positive and proving something negative. Because if you want to show that something is a Banach space, what you see here, you need to take every single Cauchy sequence and give an argument that these sequences are convergent. But if you want to show that it is not a Banach space, it is enough just to find one example where it breaks down. So the complicated part here is, of course, how can you ever guess how to choose this sequence? How can you make some sequences that are nice to work with? And I'll show you how you can do that. And actually, exactly the same example I take here is something that you can use in one of the problems also. So the question is, how can you get ideas for what to look at? And somehow we are looking at continuous functions with compact support, but you know they are sitting inside the space of functions that just go to zero for x going to plus minus infinity. So maybe it's reasonable to think about which kind of functions do we know that are continuous and then they go to zero. And actually those of you who had mathematics 2, which is something like almost all of you, maybe 90% or something like that, you know such a function, because it appeared one time as a solution to a differential equation. At the end of the course, we looked at a certain differential equation, and it turned out that we could use the power series method to find a solution to the differential equation in terms of an infinite series. And then we looked at this infinite series, and it turned out that this was just a sine function divided by the variable. And then I even showed this picture in the book. So this is, you see, for x not equal to zero, this is sine x divided by x. This is not defined for x equal to zero. So for x equal to zero, we put it equal to the limit, which is one. And then you see you get a smooth function that is one, and then it goes down, and then it oscillates like this. So you see, because of the sine, it will continue to oscillate. But because you divide by the variable, the oscillations will start by the big oscillations you have here. Then you get a smaller oscillation, a smaller one, and it continues like this. So this is an example of a function that is in C0R. That's the one we will start with. But you see, what we need here is to find a sequence of functions that have compact support. They must be continuous. They must have compact support. How can you use this function to get functions with compact support that are continuous? So how can you look at this function and then get ideas for how to define FK? Matthias?
Could we use the characteristic function in one of the points where it was zero?
Exactly, like we did in the earlier example. So you cut it off here, you cut it off here, you cut it off here, and so on. Let's try to do that. So we define the functions fk by fk of x equal to, and then we say we take sine x divided by x, and we cut it off at the places where it is zero. That means we define it like this for x belonging to an interval. And we need some intervals that grow. So let's do it from minus k pi up to k pi. And then for x equal to zero, we have to do something else because the function is not defined for zero. So for x equal to zero, we put it equal to one. And then we put it equal to zero for x outside the interval minus k pi, k pi. So if you make a small movie here, what it means is that we are looking at a function f1. This is the function f1. So it's zero outside. And then we look at the function f2, which is the same. It's going like this. But then we take the next oscillation, we include the next oscillation, and you can see what happened. Then for F3, we just continue to add. So maybe it's easier if I show it here. So F1 is the one that goes like this on the interval, and then we put it to zero here. F2 is like this, and then zero outside, and F3 is like this, and then zero outside. So that means the further out we go with the k, the more we get something that just looks like this function. So the limit function, we also need to have a function f that should be the limit, because we need to find out whether it converts to a function in CCR or not. So the natural choice for a limit function would be to say this is then sine x divided by x, and this works for all x that are not equal to 0. So this is exactly the function we have here, and then it is 1 for x equal to 0. So let's see if you can do the calculations for this function. So if you follow this program, we need to check that we have a Cauchy sequence. But actually, you have a very nice way to show that something is a Cauchy sequence. You can show that it is convergent. And I'm sure that this is not something that you're not thinking about this way, but if you look at one of our statements, and something that you actually proved yourself some weeks ago, look at this lemma, 3-1-3. What it says is that if you take any sequence that converts to something, then this sequence is automatically convergent. Sorry, it is automatically a Cauchy sequence. If you take a sequence that is convergent, then it is automatically a Cauchy sequence. So that means to check that this sequence is a Cauchy sequence, we can do it by proving that this is convergent, because then it is automatically a Cauchy sequence. So why don't show that fk actually converts to this function f? So what does it mean that fk converts to f? This means that if you look at f minus fk, measured in the norm of our space, that means this is the infinity norm, we must show that this goes to 0 as k goes to infinity. And again, if you think back to what I said in week 1, week 2, I always said it's too difficult to work with the norm, because this norm means that you're looking at f of x minus fk of x in absolute value, and then you take the supremum over all x. This is too much to do in one operation. So why don't we split it in smaller operations and look at the absolute value of f of x minus fk of x and make an estimate on that. After that, we can take the supremum. So in order to show this, I would again look at f of x minus fk of x. And I would like you to tell me, what estimate can you make on that? And I think you cannot do it while you're looking at this definition, but I guess you can do it if you look at the function. So think again about what we have done. F of x, this is the function that oscillates like this over the entire axis. Fk of x is the one that oscillates like this, but only until we hit the point, I mean, inside the interval from minus k pi up to k pi. Outside that, it is just equal to 0. So when we look at f of x minus f1 of x, this means we are looking at the function that oscillates like this, and then we are subtracting f1. That means we are subtracting the function that oscillates like the first one. That means what is left is something that is 0 on this interval, and then it oscillates like this for the rest. So if you think about this argument, then you can actually make an estimate on that. So I claim that independently of our x, we can say that this is smaller than or equal to something. Nikolai, did you give up? You were on the way to say something?
I just wanted to say that we would say if we want to get the integral about the difference we could integrate from k pi to infinity or not, and then to the time.
So you say we can integrate, but here we cannot integrate because we are just speaking about difference in function values. So we cannot integrate at this point. Jakob?
Well, the supremum is attained outside the interval k pi. And sine is also always smaller than 1. So that difference must be smaller than 1 over k pi.
So now just repeat what you say. You say the first function this oscillate that, like sine x divided by x over the interval. Fk of x also oscillate like this function, but only on the interval minus k pi up to k pi. That means if you look at x belonging to minus k pi up to k pi, then the difference between f of x and fk of x is zero, because they are the same function. So that means we only need to look at f of x and fk of x outside this interval minus k pi up to k pi. And there you say the first one is equal to zero, and the other one goes like sinus x divided by x. And what is the maximum value this function can take? Because the sine function at most can be 1, then the max value that you can get here outside the interval minus k pi up to k pi, this is the value 1 divided by k pi. This is completely correct. So that means the estimate we can put here is that this is smaller than or equal to 1 divided by k pi. And this holds for all x in R. And the way that you see it holds for all x is that first you look at what is inside the interval minus k pi up to k pi. And here the difference is equal to 0, which is smaller than this. And then you look at somehow from minus infinity up to minus k pi, and you look from k pi up to infinity. And on these intervals, you have this estimate. Since this holds for all x, you can conclude that the infinity norm of f minus fk, which is then the supremum of what we just calculated, supremum of absolute value f of x minus fk of x. Since all these differences are smaller than or equal to 1 divided by k pi, also the supremum is smaller than or equal to 1 divided by k pi. And this goes to 0 as k tends to infinity. So what this shows is that the sequence fk, k equal to 1 up to infinity, this is actually a sequence that is convergent inside this space, because it converts to a function in the space C0R. So now we are in the situation that we have seen that it is convergent in this space. Therefore, it is also a Cauchy sequence according to the lemma I just showed you. So the argument already shows that it converts to this function, f. So we have a sequence of functions in CCR, and it converts to exactly the function f we are dealing with, f that belongs to C0R. So if you look at this limit function, this is the one we have here. This does not have compact support. So this is not a function in CCR. So that means we have a Cauchy sequence, and it converts to something, but this something does not belong to the right space. This tells us that our Cauchy sequence is not convergent within our space. So actually, if you go back and look at this, again, the definition of Banach space, it says every Cauchy sequence in the space must converge to something that belongs to the space. What we have shown here is actually we have a convergent sequence, but it does not converge to something that is in the space. It converges to something that is outside the space. So this shows that our space is not a Banach space. So this is a type of argument where you really need to sit down in your student house and think for some time to find out that this argument is correct. First time you hear it, you really need to look at it to find out that it is correct. But during this week and next week, and I think even the week after, you'll get a lot of exercises where you have to show that something is not a Banach space or something is not a Hilbert space. And the argument will always be like the one we have here. So I'm sure that after next week or something like that, you'll actually understand this argument. So please think about it for some time. Already today, you'll get a chance to do that at the problem session. So this was the hard piece of mathematics for today. At the end of the lecture, I might give you some more mathematics, but before we do that, I would like to give you a small application. Actually, from the very first week, I wanted to give you applications of the material in Mathematics 4, but it has been very difficult to do that, because in order to make any sense out of the applications, there are some mathematics that we need to know first. Now we're at the point where we have enough mathematics to be able to show how it connects to real life. So very often, in as well physics as just engineering, you look at something that you could just call a system. So a system in, let's say, physics very often you model this like some kind of black box where there's some input and there's something coming out. So some kind of black box with input and output. And some output. So let's just make a small figure of that. So this means that you have something that comes in, you act with a certain force on a mechanical system, and then a certain action comes out of this. So the black box is here. And then you get some kind of output signal. So let's look at a few cases of this. For example, in electrical engineering, so now we're doing something concrete. So you might have some voltage that you put on a certain circuit. So you have an input, which is some voltage that depend on the time. And then you have that this goes to a certain system. And you know how this looks like, something like this. And then, for example, the output you'd like to have could be that you have another component here, and then you want to measure the voltage over this component. So the output, this is the voltage here, and you could call this Y of t, and this is the voltage that you can measure here. This could be one example. Another one could be in mechanical engineering, that you have a certain system and then you pressure on that system. And actually, I'm not very good to make a figure of that, but I think you understand what I mean. So we have a spring. And actually, I had to check in the dictionary what the English word is. The English word is spring. The Danish word is fjeder. So you can think about that there's something here, and then you pressure on this with some force. So the input is some x of t, which is a certain pressure. And the output could be how much you displace this object when you pressure on it. For example, this is what happens if you go to the bedroom on Saturday and you jump on the scale to see your weight. Then this just means that this is the figure like this, just turned like this, and you jump on it, and then you go off and you see what the weight is. That could be one example of this. So the output y of t, this is the displacement, how much this object moves. So this object I'm speaking about, this is actually this one. I would like to state one more, and this is from image analysis. So in image analysis, let's think about x of t as a certain image. And then we put this into a certain black box. And then what you get out as output is what is called a blurred image. So again, blurred, what does it mean? The Danish word is udsværet. Udsværet image. So I have some examples of that, so you can see what we are speaking about. So this is not very good. Actually, you will get a much better version of this, because on the next USL, I have an exercise about this, and you'll see a much better picture than what we have here. But what it shows is, this is the original image, and then when you make this blurring, everything is smeared a little bit out, so you get something like this, or you get something like this. So you can see you are somehow taking away some details in the picture. And this is something that is relevant. For example, if the original picture shows some artifacts that you don't want to be there, then you can somehow smear them out so they are not that visible. It can also be that the first version of the picture, the original one, so the one up here, that it contains some noise, and then actually by making this blurring, you are smearing it a little bit out so you don't get the noise in the same way. These are three examples of what you could call physical systems or engineering systems. And interesting things about these systems from the point of view of Mathematics 4 is that all of them are modeled with mathematics that we're dealing with in this course. So it turns out that systems of this type, they are modeled using integral operators. So systems of this type, they are often modeled using integral operators. And what this means is that the relationship between this input signal x of t and the output signal y of t, this is something that you can write down in terms of an operator. So this means there's a certain function k of two variables. Usually it takes real values, but such that if you want to find out what the output signal is, that means you are putting in your x of t and you want to find out what y of t is, then you can write it down in terms of an operator equation. Namely, y of t is given as an integral. Sometimes it is an integral from some a to b. Sometimes it's from minus infinity to infinity. So let's just look at the case from minus infinity to infinity. And what you have to integrate is something that has to do with the input signal. X of s, that's the one that you throw into the system. So that's the one you have here. So you take your input signal and you integrate it against this so-called kernel function, the function of two variables. So here you have k of s, comma t, and you make the integral with respect to s. So that means if you want to find your output signal at a certain time t, what you do is you take this kernel of two variables, but you look at it as variable of s, you multiply it with the incoming signal, and then you make an integration over all of s. So you see what happened here is exactly that you start with the x of s, and then it gets mapped onto the y of t. What is this? This is an operator. So if you formulate that in terms of mathematics 4, then this says that y, the function y, is equal to a certain operator k applied to the input signal x, where k is the operator. And k is the operator that takes x and maps it onto exactly what we see here. So k is the operator such that k applied to the signal x and evaluated in the time t, this is the same as exactly this. So this is the integral from minus infinity to infinity, k s comma t times x s ds. And you know, engineers, they know very well to work with things like that without knowing about mathematics 4. So in a certain sense, engineers, they can very well survive without mathematics 4. They don't need to specify what is the domain, I mean, which exact signals can we put in, which exact signals can we get out. They usually don't worry about this kind of things. But you see, you can take what is going on in engineering and you can formulate it such that it fits exactly into the framework of what we're doing in mathematics 4. So what kind of questions come up here? I mean, I could test you and ask, are you satisfied now, or what do we need to know now before we are happy? I mean, as mathematicians. What kind of questions would you like to ask in this setting? Alexander?
If the integral is well-defined.
You would like to know if the integral is well-defined. And you don't want that the integral is just well-defined for one function. You want the integral to be well-defined for the class of signals you want to put in. So the question is, when is k well-defined? And it is clear, in order to give good answers to this kind of questions, you need to put some assumptions. Because if you don't know anything about this function that is here, k with small k, if you don't know anything about this function of two variables, you cannot say anything about when this operator is well-defined. So we need to put some assumptions on the k. So let's do that. So let's assume that this function is bounded. So that means we assume that there is some constants, which are now called c, such that if you look at all function values, k of s, t, an absolute value, then this is smaller than or equal to some constant c. Now, the question I would like to ask is the operator k well-defined? And I would like to look at two cases. First, let's ask the question, is it well-defined if this input signal, if it belongs to one of the classes that we introduced today, namely the continuous functions that go to zero, for x going to plus minus infinity? Or is this well defined for x belonging to L1 of R? And I'm not sure that we will do all the details for both of them, but I will make some space now, and then I would like to hear, what do you think about these two? Can we answer these questions? So what do you think about the first question? What about if x is a continuous function that goes to zero for x going to plus minus infinity? You don't look happy. You say no. Actually, this is correct. The answer is no here. I think we are close to 3 o'clock, so I don't think I will give the argument for that, but it's actually correct. So if some of you would like to know the argument, then please just speak to me at the problem session. Actually, next week you'll get a homework assignment, which again has to do with this blurring we're speaking about here. And you'll get some similar questions like this, but with this assumption replaced by something else. So you get to look at questions of this type yourself. But what about the last question? If x belongs to L1, Andreas? Why?
Because you can simply put up a bound and integrate it and just pull out C you have assumed to be the upper bound of the and so you know the integrate of the signal will be finite, then you have a finite number of times C and that is correct.
So what you say is we want to show that this is well defined. So we look at this integral, but we look at it with absolute value inside. So let's do that. So we have the integral from minus infinity to infinity k s t x of s, and then the absolute value ds. You know from mathematics 2, when we had to make estimates of this type, we did not have an integral, we had a sum, and what we did was always to use this comparison theorem, where we try to estimate some of these terms, saying that something was smaller than something else, and then we put an inequality here. And that's exactly what you said, Andreas, that we should do the same here. So the assumption is that k of st in absolute value is smaller than or equal to some constant c. But this also means that if we look at this integral and we replace this factor by something that is larger, namely the factor of c, then we get a new integral, and we get a new integral that is larger. So we get this is smaller than or equal to integral minus infinity to infinity. And instead of this factor, we get the value c, and then what is left here is the absolute value of x s ds. But this is exactly the same as taking the constant out. So this is c times the integral from minus infinity to infinity, x of s in absolute value ds. And our assumption was exactly that x belongs to L1. This means exactly that this integral is finite. That's the way we defined it. So this is finite. So then according to the lemma we had last hour, since this integral with an absolute value turns out to give something finite, then also the integral without absolute value is well defined. So this is by the lemma from last hour, lemma 172. So I hope this gives you an intuition that even though we are doing a lot of mathematics, it is not just mathematics that are just for the sake of mathematics, but it's actually something that plays a role in the context of various operators that appear to you in your engineering career. So I think you had more than enough mathematics for today, so let's meet at the problem session.